Good afternoon and welcome to the 23rd meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for this afternoon's meeting. Our first agenda item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the Draft Age of Criminal Responsibility, Reports on Use of Places of Safety, Scotland Regulations 2022. And I welcome to the meeting Claire Hawkey, Minister for Children and Young People, who's accompanied by Lindsay McKean, Police Powers Team Leader at the Scottish Government. You're both very welcome, and I refer members to paper one. Now I invite the Minister to speak to the draft regulations. Minister.
Thank you and good afternoon, Convener and Committee, and thank you for your invitation to address the Committee in relation to this SSI. This SSI sets out the information which will be contained in the annual report to Parliament on the use of the police of safety power contained in Section 28 of the Act. This section provides Police Scotland with the power to take a child under the age of 12 to a place of safety where they consider the child is behaving or likely to behave in a way that is causing or risks causing significant harm to another person. This SSI has been developed since the commencement of the Act on the 17th of December 2021, which means it's been informed by the first few months of the legislation operating in practice. The police have only used this power on four occasions since December. In developing this SSI, I've taken into account of the fact that this power has only been required infrequently and the subsequent risk that poses to compromising the identity of a child when reporting information to Parliament. Therefore, the information that will be reported to Parliament as set out in this SSI does not contain the same level of detail which Police Scotland record and provide to ministers. The essential difference is that it does not focus on specific dates, times and location of a child being taken to a place of safety. Instead, the report will contain detail on the length of time a child was at a place of safety, how many times in a month a place of safety was used, and the number of times each place of safety included in the Act was used within the reporting period. The SSI has been designed to ensure that the reports laid in Parliament safeguard the identity of children while furnishing Parliament with information on the safe and proper use of the power. I believe this SSI does that without materially altering the intent and information received by ministers. We have collaborated with Police Scotland on the development of this instrument to ensure that its terms are appropriate, deliverable, proportionate and underpinned by the principles of the Act. And we have also informally consulted with stakeholders, including organisations with a strong focus on children's rights. The Act requires ministers to carry out a review of the operation of the Act and to consider the future age of criminal responsibility. Should the age of criminal responsibility be raised or the frequency of the use of the power increase, this SSI can be modified to require reports to include further information. Scottish ministers will look to provide Parliament with the first report in early 2023, following the passing of the first year of the implementation of the Act. I hope that this provides the committee with a helpful overview of this statutory instrument.
Thank you very much, Minister. Open the floor for questions from members. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for setting out the detail of the affirmative document we have. I'm really pleased to hear the point about raising the age of criminal responsibility, because as you'll be aware, the current age in Scotland is lower than the UNCRC would consider. Can the Minister set out whether or not the Government is currently considering raising the age? And also, can you comment on the fact that the Children's Rights and Wellbeing Impact Assessment states within it that the SSI is in fact UNCRC compliant, but then the legislation that it relates to is not UNCRC compliant, given the ages are incompatible?
Sure, I'll take the first part of that question and then I'll hand over to Lindsay in terms of the compliance there. So the Act placed a duty on Scottish ministers to review the operation of the Act, both in general and with a view to considering the future age of criminal responsibility. The three-year review period started on the 17th of December last year, and that was the day that Section 1 of the Act came into force. And in carrying out that review, Scottish ministers must consult such persons as they consider appropriate and must lay a report to Parliament within 12 months of the completion of the review period. So an advisory group has been established to support that work over that time, and that advisory group has been meeting since the summer of 2019. And the review will ensure that this the operational learning and experience from the implementation of the legislation will inform the discussions that we have about future age of criminal responsibility in Scotland. So I hope that gives the member an overview of some of the work that is ongoing. And I'm sure that's something that we'll come back to in the future as that review reports.
Thank you.
Lindsay, are you able to answer on that?
Well, I can provide a slight overview in terms of the CREA. The impact assessments were specifically for this SSI, so it's on the use of the place of safety power rather than the Act in general. So the age of criminal responsibility is currently under the UNCRC, and as the Minister has explained, there will be a review period, and we will look to see if the age of criminal responsibility can and should be increased. With regards to the CREA, is simply about the use of this place of safety power, and that's therefore why we've said that in terms of how we've analysed that and analysed the SSI, that's why we've said that that's CREA compliant, if that's helpful.
That's helpful. Thank you. Thank you.
And Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. Like Pam Duncan Glancy, I welcome the talk around the possibility of looking at the age being increased, because that was something when we scrutinised this bill that was a major talking point for the committee members who were involved in that, as was the place of safety, which is what this instrument's obviously about. And I do welcome the explanation given that it's only been used 4 times. I wonder though if the Minister would be able to answer just one question. It's actually come up through some of my constituency work, so I'll take the opportunity to ask. I've had some constituents asking, because of the legislation that's now in place, they were under the impression that the police could now no longer talk to children under that age. Not about children, but no longer talk to children under that age. I wonder if the Minister is able to confirm for me that that's not in fact the case, and that the police can still engage with children as they can with any other member of the community. Advice that I gave to my constituent, but he asked that I raise it in a parliamentary manner.
Yes, I can confirm that's correct, that police can engage with children under the age of 12.
That's really helpful to have on the record, thank you.
Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe, and thank you, Minister, for providing that information so far. Just a quick point of clarity around the types of information that will be reported. Will we be able to connect those different types of information? So for instance, there's provision to report when a child is being very violent or is likely to cause violence to somebody else. They can be, and only then, kept in a police cell. If that violence is directed at themselves only, and they're not in a police cell, will we be able to connect one of the pieces of behaviour, the nature of the behaviour, with where they are kept, if it's not the police cell?
So I think it'd be really helpful just to establish for the committee and for the record that a police cell will only be used in one very rare circumstance, and that would be where a child is behaving in an exceptionally violent manner or their behaviour poses extreme risk to someone else. The place of safety... To go for police to take a child to a police station, never mind the next step, a police cell, would be very unusual. Police would contact if police had concerns about a child and they were using these powers, they would contact social work in the local authority to help identify a relevant place that would be in the best needs of the child in terms of a place of safety. So that could be various places that local authorities have identified. So it could be care home, it could be hospital if that child had identified medical needs. So a police station would be the last resort, yeah. really. And the use of a police cell would be an absolute extremis.
And I suppose, given what you've said, which is welcome, welcome clarification, it would be possible to identify the types of behaviour that are connected with the cell as a place of safety. Will it be possible to connect the types of behaviour that are associated with other places of safety?
Sorry, I'm trying to think. So there would only be one reason for a child to be kept in a place of safety as a cell, yeah. and that would be that, as I'd outlined earlier, exceptionally violent manner or posing an acute threat to someone else. In terms of the other, why someone would go to another place of safety, it would be the police would be liaising with social work, who would be taking a very holistic view, using GERFEC to look at what was in the best interest of that child, where there would be a place that would best suit their needs. So they would be looking at it from, a child protection, child safeguarding point of view to where that child should be, to go to a place of safety until they were able to be returned home or to another appropriate adult.
Okay. I was just about connecting the numbers with the different locations. But
Yep, Lindsay,
thanks.
No, that's fine. Yes, so within the SSI, we have a clause that says the nature of the behaviour or likely behaviour which was considered to be causing or risk causing significant harm to another person. So that's essentially saying, why have you taken a child to a place of safety? What was the nature of their behaviour? And within Police Scotland records, they will have essentially kind of drop-down menus, and there will be... so it will be quite high level. It won't be in too much detail, and the reason for that being is so that we're not risking identifying a child.
That was where
there
I was
will
going with
be
that.
A connection as to why a child is in a place of safety.
No, that's really helpful. Thank you both for that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Any further points, questions? No. Okay, no further indications. So we'll now move on to agenda item 2, which is consideration of the motion for approval of the affirmative instrument. So I invite the Minister to move that motion S6M04890 be approved.
It moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do any members have any other final comments? Okay, no members any final comments. So are we all agreed? OK, thank you. That is agreed. So I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we've considered today. Is that agreed? Yes. Great. Thank you. That concludes consideration of the affirmative instrument. And I thank the Minister and officials for attending. And the next item of... And you're good to go. The next item on our agenda is consideration of a negative instrument, and I refer members to paper 2. Do members have any comments on SSI 2022/214, the Sheriff Court Fees Amendment Order 2022? Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I was just keen to know how the errors happened and how and when they were identified.
So again, obviously we don't have a minister here. Did we have any? So I think that the annex of the note probably has that information. There is no time for us to come back to ask questions, but obviously there is opportunities for members to seek that information. It's probably best, I guess, just to say to members, if they have a question like that for a negative instrument, if we get that to the clerks beforehand, then we can make an effort to get those answers. Obviously, the Parliament's decided that these instruments are taken by negative instruments. Pam?
Thank you.
As well, that the actual letter fails to mention why the issue wasn't identified by the Scottish Tribunals and the court services, so why was that the case? It's not in there.
So, as I say, there isn't time for us to bring this back to a future meeting in terms of the process. So,
we can find out from officials, or the committee can choose to run it.
So, I mean, if there's a number of folk think that this is something we'd be keen to get an answer to, then we can write. But if a member has an issue with this, then obviously it would be for the member to lodge a motion to annul in the chamber, and that would be the process. There isn't a process back to this committee, but certainly if there's, you know, folk across the chamber are feeling that that's something we want to do, then
with convener, without being as dramatic as putting forward a motion to annul, is there an opportunity at that point to ask, at the point of voting, for clarification in terms of a statement? Is that something that can be done?
This is a negative instrument, so I think it's the opportunity really is for us to make comments here, to put them on the record, and it would then be for, if there had been more time, you could ask the Minister to come back, but there isn't time for this particular instrument. So are we okay if we write to, is that, so we'll ask the clerks to write and we'll get that back. I guess I would just encourage us all to try, and if we can do that in advance, then it's possible that clerks can try and get the information if it's not in the annexes that we receive from the government. It may be there someplace and we're just not seeing it. But okay, that being the case, obviously we've agreed to write to the minister and to the government, and we'll make no further comments. So that concludes consideration of the SSI. We'll now move into private session for the final items on our agenda.